Today, the sugya, the daf, tractate Bava Metzia, page 63, dealing with a lot of practical halachot. Here are some examples of the discussion today. Reuven and Shimon. Reuven purchased a car. And as you know, when you're purchasing a car, you have a period of time that if you are unhappy, not only with car, but can be in other materials, you have a period you can return it. Months later, Reuven comes to Shimon and he said, I don't like the car. I don't want it. He was back, your car. The problem is, Reuven gave to Shimon 25K in advance when he purchased the car. Shimon now returned the 25K, and guess what the problem? The 25K Shimon used during that 30 days. The question is that the problem of rebate, of interest? Another phase to that is ha'aramat rebit, which is you buying a certain merchandise in the low price because the seller is temporarily under pressure of fund, of cash needed, and then you quote-unquote sell it back to him in the highest price because in a way it is advantage of the both parties. The lender gets interest, the buyer, or the seller, the one who gave it, he needs cash immediately. So he said, here is my property, there are fruits there, there is a business there, enjoy the fruit, and when I have my money, you can have it. So that's different phase of ha'aramat rebit. It's a question in that sense that was asked the great Rav of Strasbourg. He asked if a fellow owns a car dealership and sometimes in that business they need cash. So Reuven, who owns a car dealership, he borrowed 250K, real case, 250K from Shimon. And time passed, they agree over a frame of work of time, and Reuven is under pressure, it's a year, he didn't pay him back, it wasn't an interest, but he still, Shimon said, I need my money back. So Reuven said to him, look, I ask you only to give me 2 months, 60 days. I'm giving you cars in my yard, in my dealership, that's worth 300K. Keep them, use them, do whatever you want in 2 months, okay? If in 2 months I'm not bringing you back the money, it's yours. And the question is, in one hand, you can say that it's mekach u'mimkar, is buying and selling. But the condition of 300K on the surface, it's a question of interest. Even you can argue and say that it was a precondition in certain ways. But if you think about the framework, it's about ha'aramat ribit, about to artifice the law of interest. Similar question was asked the late Shevet Halevi, the late Rav Vozner. He was asked about from a very well-known Morei Hora'ah in New York City. The question was asked, it was four partners in the real estate business. They own a lot of buildings in New Jersey area. And they bought a very large property, and they all the four partners come to conclusion there is endless expenses, especially in the first 2 years. Those who are involved in real estate know that it's never, the expectation never meet the reality. It's not just the issue of vacancies, it's not just the issue of violation of green card by the states. It's other things that unexpected under the surface that many times, as much as the seller gives you a disclaimer, it's still there for expenses. So they decided to make a special account, and they agreed between the four parties is to put a money in that account, equal money from each partner in a first year each month. And they made an agreement that if someone does not put the money, he will get a fine. He needs to pay that joint account an extra fine. So it turned, for example, just using example, it was $5,000 a month that each partner needs to put. So one of the partners, obviously, after a year, he owed $60,000 to that joint account. So since it's a large real estate, that fellow said, they came to him and says, okay, year passed by, we have an agreement. You need to pay $100. Why? Because we have the $60,000 you owe, and we have the fine that we agree in advance. So that Morel asked Rav Vozner, is that meet the halacha? Why? Because in one hand, these partners said to them, look, I am willing to pay what I owe originally. The other partner said, no, we agree originally that each partner in a monthly basis put the money there. He said, but that's a joint account to use expenses, and you've not exceeded that account over the year. The other partner said, that's not the deal. The deal was in advance that each partner puts the money, and one who's not putting the money every month needs to pay a fine. So the question is that knas? Is that just a fine? Or is that a interest, a rebate? So again, this is one of the responses of the Shevet HaLevi, the Rav Vozner. Another example, it's the idea of forbidden gift. It's a real story. One real estate agent needs some parnasa, some income. So he was somewhat sporadic because, you know, in real estate, sometimes you have months that you make a lot, sometimes it's a long period without. So that fellow made money on the commission and earned enough, but had a little extra. So what did he do? He required several $1,000s in loans to get him through the time between commissions. So he had a simple practice to help him produce the loans. He gave a gmach, a Hebrew free loan. He gave that gmach administrators a very nice gift. And it's not surprising that he was always happy to lend him money. When he mentioned that strategy to a friend, the friend said, wait a second, it's not the issue of rebit. So they asked a question, the late great Rav Yosef Shalom Eliashiv. Let me translate to you from the book Piskei HaGrisha in Ilchot Rebit, Rav Eliashiv answer. He said that in general it is permitted to give gifts to administrators of gmachim, of a Hebrew free loan, even if the administrator is the person who gave the money for the gmach from his own personal funds. This is permitted, but there is an exception to this rule. If there are limited funds and the gift giver gets a loan instead of others who would have precedes him, but for his gift, then, since his gift caused another to unfairly lose out, so therefore he must not give them. So it's all a question if the gmach have enough money for everyone, it's not an issue. But if it's on account of someone else and because of the gift, then we have an issue of rebit. So as you see, all those issues of rebate directly or indirectly in interest is in our discussion. And we are starting with 62b, nine lines from the top of the page. Keitzad lakach imenu chitim bedinar zahav akor, vechen hashar. So we learn in the Mishnah, Reuven, just using names, Reuven, he gave to Shimon dinar, a golden dinar, and which is 25 a silver dinar, in exchange of a wheat. And then the wheat turns higher. So that's the question, if it's that considering a ribit de Rabbanan. It's a rabbinic form of interest, because he paid for the wheat but did not take immediate delivery. So what happened is, you have here the wheat price, but the wheat price increased and stood at 30 silver dinars, and we said many times, it's not the dinars, it's the idea of value. So the Mishnah brings us example of tarbit. Tarbit is, as we explained in the past several days, is the rabbinic prohibition of interest. So the Gemara asks a question over this scenario, of this example of the case, because what we learned so far, just real vignette of the discussion in the past. Number one, we said that we cannot make a deal in advance in a way to make money over produce. For example, Reuven needs cash and he gives a produce to Shimon in a very low price, and the whole deal in advance is that he gives back to him when he have the cash. The problem is that when Shimon get it, the produce increase the price, and therefore by a rabbinic law is prohibited as an interest. Now we have a concept that we're going to elaborate later, which is yesh law, which means if one party have at the time, for example, the seller have at the time of the deal, you have this type of produce, and even he gives the buyer a different produce later on, but it's considering yeshlo, it's considering that he have. Or the third option is kol yatza ha-sha'ar, when they basically the market value is on a fixed price. So therefore one party does a barter for another, you give me wheat, I give you wine, etc. And the market value, it's on a fixed price, so one forgive the debt of the other by paying back from his produce. So anyway, the Gemara asks, v'chi ein lo yain mai have, if one party doesn't have the wine, so what's the problem? Because you have here transactions between parties, you have agreement, so if it's a clear price we have in advance for the wine, so what's the problem? So it's like yatzah ashar, it's like fixed market value that made between two parties in advance. That not. So we're now going to bring a Mishnah on page 72b. The Mishnah said as follows: Ein poskin al haperot ad sheyitze hasha'ar. So when you have a contract between two parties, one cannot enter the contract in advance for certain produce in condition that he will give it later on, because there is a concern that the price will change, and therefore he gets money in advance that it's a containing interest, until you have a clear prevailing market price. But then yatsa hashar, when we have prevailing market price, poskin, so therefore you go and make a contract for a price for those produce, af al pi she'en laze yesh laze, even though the one party that the buyer is have the contract does not have the produce in his stock, someone else does have it. So they have the produce that available. So we take it, this the buyer is have the contract, and the produce is in stock, and the contract is permitted. So the question is, in our Mishnah, what we said? We said in the Mishnah that when you have the wine market in the fixed price, why is forbidden the transaction when the seller has no wine? Amar Rabba, and some said Rava, Matnitin beva lachov bidmehem askinan. We have here a Mishnah, a situation when the seller takes upon himself the present value of the wheat and he take it as the debt. Now, you see that the intention is to discharge by delivering an agreed amount of wine, and that's in advance at a certain price, and basically certain price, but the time of delivery is a later date. So because you have no income, no money at that very present of the time, the existence of a prevailing price is not grounds for permitting the transaction. So, Rashi goes that way, but the Chatam Sofer, the Pnei Yehoshua, and others said that it's not necessarily the market value. It's the idea that he gets a cash in advance for something that in a present time is not totally existed. Anyway, Vich de Tanya. That's the way we learn Braita, the difference between make a fixed price for in advance for produce by giving money versus someone that deal with a death, which is someone owe him a certain amount of money. הרי שהיה נושה בחברו מנה. You have fellow Reuven owed Shimon a X amount of money. Mane, let's say 1,000 K. והלך ועמד על גורנו, and Shimon, the creditor, went and stood on the one who owed him, which is Reuven, threshing floor. ואמר, תן לי מאותיי, give me my money, שאני רוצה לקח בהם חיטים, that I want to use that money to purchase wheat. אמר לו, so the borrower said to the lender, wait, חיטים יש לי, I have in my stock a wheat, and שאני נותן לך, that I'm giving you as paying for the money I owed you, if you agree. But if you are not, tze vaaseli kashar shel achshav. Go and take the money and replace it, what I owe you into debt of wheat, on the current price. ואני אעלה לך כל 12 חודש. And later I will deliver the wheat to you through the next year according to the market rate of now. So they said, Asu, you cannot have, it's forbidden to have this type of transactions. The love כאיסרו הבל לידו דמי. It's not like a case where you have a coin that's called in those days Isar, which means he gives him a, the Shita Mekubetzet explains that he gives him a currency of money equivalent or the same that he owe, and he can buy now with that money So it's a because the seller is not being in a way pay fully cash. But if you go by the way that one owes someone, posek bechovo, so he cannot transfer that debt to the wheat. So he cannot take the wheat to the wine. Why? Because the wine is forbidden because the seller is not receiving cash. So that's basically the question we presented at the very beginning. Because what we said? We said at the very beginning, if someone purchased a car, meaning you purchase a car, you pay, for example, 25K, and after a month you do not wish to keep this car, and you return it, and the fellow gave you back the 25K, the question is, based on that, in one hand, the seller, the car dealership, invested a lot of money in his good reputation. He wants people to know that if you're unhappy, money back guarantee, as they said. So the question is, you can say that it depends upon the intent, and it's not really a rebate. Anyway, Amar le Abaye, I de lo ke isaro haba liado. Abaye said, if you treated not like a isar coin that comes into his hand, because the seller is not being paid cash. So therefore, my iria en lo, afilu yeshlo name. Why, when we have the Mishnah specified that the transaction is forbidden because the seller has no wine at the time the debt is transferred from the wheat to the wine, even if the one who owes money does have a wine at the time, the transaction ought also to be forbidden, following the braita that we just quoted. Now, the Pnei Yehoshua, based on the Rashi here as a malach, because the whole idea is, if it's a mekachumim car, if you do it in a way of buying and selling product, so it's one thing, but if you're buying the debt in the way that people take a loan, that's the issue of rebit. That's the way the Shita Mekubetzet explain and others. Anyway, since we have this problem with the Abaye, come out with a different explanation of this Mishnah. And he said, El Amar Abaye matnitin kedetane Rav Safra beribit devei Rabbi Chiya. The Tane Rav Safra beribit devei Rabbi Chiya. Yesh dvarim shem mutarim vasurim mipnei haramat ribit keitzad. You have certain things that written in the Torah that we all know that is prohibited. There are certain things that the rabbis came in and said, even it's not written in the Torah, we prohibited that because they are an evasion of the interest prohibition. That's like artifice, like circumventing the system, but it's prohibited. Keitzad, here's an example. Amar lo, Reuven said to Shimon, Halveni mane, I need a $10,000 loan. Amar lo, mane enli, Shimon said to Reuven, I do not have the 10K. Chitin b'mane yeshli, I have a produce, for example, a wheat, that's worth 10K. She'ani noten lecha, I'm giving it to you, that has the value of 10K. Natan lo chitin b'mane, so he gives him the wheat in that value. V'chazar ul kachan emenu b'24 sela. So he repurchase from the bower that wheat cheaper, which means the maneh in those days was 25 sla'im. And he basically, because the borrower is pressed for fund, so he cannot wait for the market day when things get in a full price, mutar. So biblically speaking, it's okay. V'asur la'asot ken mipnei haramat ribit. And but it's forbidden to do so in practice because it is an evasion of interest prohibition. It was a case that was brought to the more contemporary rabbis. There are businesses that only in a certain season. For example, we get into winter time, in the freezing cold, the coat that made out of either animals or silk that looks like fox and other animals, they made the expensive coats. So you have a fellow who was a long time in this business, and unfortunately in his warehouses, this is a very hot July, August, and you have for 150K coats in a large room in his warehouse. The problem is he needs cash. He needs cash for either for his basic livings or other businesses. And the time he knew that when it's come to December, January, he can sell each coat for full price. But at this very moment, no one in the hot summer wants to buy a fur coat. So the question is, can someone take advantage of his situation and buy it in a very cheap price because of his situation? That's what we call is forbidden to do because it's an invasion of ribit prohibition. Now, that's one of the reasons we have Gemach, we have a Hebrew free loan, to help people, especially sometimes people misconstrue the concept of rich and poor. There are people who have a lot of merchandise or even cash in some place, but sometimes it's invested in certain business that bring the produce later, and at this very moment they have no, how they say it here, someone can drive an expensive Mercedes and you have no money for gasoline. Right? So it happens sometimes. There are people who need immediate money for their survival. So the Gemach is not only for the poor, it can be for the wealthy needs in a temporary time until things settle. Anyway, so Rabbi said, Hachanami, also here in our Mishnah, Kegon de'amar halveni 30 dinarim. For example, Mishnah is speaking in a case which someone said to his fellow, lend me 30 silver dinars, as we said, is just an example of ancient currency, but can be converted to a current one, is the concept. Amar li 30 dinarim en li, cash of 30 dinar I do not have at this time. Chitin be 30 dinarim yesh li, I have a wheat that has a value of 30 dinar. She'ani noten lecha, so what I'm going to give you, I'm giving you, it's called in Ivrit behakafa, which is, I'm giving you it in advance, but I expect it back. Natan lo chitim b'shloshim nidarim. V'chazam ol kacha mimenu b'dinar zahav. So then he basically bought it back from him, for a gold dinar, which is 25 silver dinar. So what you see here? You see here that he basically have a aramat ribit. He's taking money in an artificial way and he's making the difference. So there's a problem by a rabbinic law. He it le chamra lelove deiv lebe 30 dinar. If the borrower has wine, that's the concept we explained earlier of Yeshlo. So, therefore, the Yahiv le bishloshim dinar, that he is prepared to give him as this very moment for the money he owe him of 30 dinars, peira hu deka shakil minei. So then it is produce that the lender accept from the other party as advance payment. The late land, we have no issue with that because it doesn't appear as ha'aramat ribit, because in advance when he repurchased the wheat back, he gave him cash. The Ramban, Rabbeinu Moshe ben Nachman, explains that we must differentiate between peirot, between produce, and cash. He holds that when it's come to produce, it doesn't look like ha'aramah. And therefore he holds that it's not an isur. Ve'ilo, but if the borrower doesn't have wine, kevan delate lechamra, so since he doesn't have wine, so he needs to pay cash, vaday mishkal zuzei minei mechzei keribit. So he was taking money from him, and basically it appears, it looks like it's an interest, because he gave him 25 dinars, and the money he collected is 30. That's the way Rashi explains. The code in Yoredei Akuf Samech Gimel 163 said that when it's come to a produce is okay, as we mentioned earlier, the Ramban. Many poskim hold that ha'aramat ribit is in a way lenient, less than regular ribit de Rabbanan. And they call it avak ribit, and they said it's only lechatchila. Anyway, Amar lei Rava, Rava say to Abaye, ihachi, if you tell me that the Mishnah meant when the lender said ten lichitai, why does the Mishnah quote the lender saying, give me my wheat? Dmei chitai mi ba'elei. He needs to say, give me the monetary value of my wheat, not the wheat itself. So they said, tnei dmei chitai. So you have to read the Mishnah, give me the value of my wheat. So the rabbi asked further on, according to what the lender said in the Mishnah, he said to the borrower, She'ani mochran, or there is another one that, She'ani rotze lemochran, that I wish to sell the wheat and buy wine. So what you see? You see by the way the Abaye tells us that the lender is demanding what? Not the wheat, he wants the money, he wants the cash value. So therefore, the lender needs to say, according to your explanation, interpretation as follows. Shemchartim lecha miba'ayalei. So therefore, he said, give me the value of the wheat that I sold you previously. So, if I sold you previously the wheat, give me the money of that wheat. So the Abaye said, "Tnei shemechartim lecha." So the Mishnah should be read, give me the value of the wheat that I sold you. So the Rava asked further on, what exactly you meant when the borrower said to the lender, Harei chitecha asuyot alai bishloshim dinarim. When we said, you wheat is assumed by me as the money you owe him in a value of 30 dinar. Me'ikara name acheuk mino elavei. So he said that even from the very outset, this was the way that they made all the setup arrangement in advance. Now, if you go by the language of the Mishnah, only now he accept upon himself to pay 30 dinar. So Abaye responded and said, "Hachika amarli." That's the way the lend the borrower said to the lender. Bidmei chitecha she'asita alai b'shloshim dinar. So he said, for the value of your wheat that you made into a loan of 30 dinar for me, harei lecha etzli bahen yain. So I, you can hereby have with me a claim of wine in Easter. V'yayin en lo. And the Mishnah concludes, but there is no wine. So it means that the Mishnah doesn't mean that now they make a deal of 30 dinar for the wheat, because you can't say that they now set up a price of 30. That was, in a way, a setup. But the agreement was the exchange. The Mishnah said he bought the wheat at one gold dinar per kor, and that was the prevailing price. So what do you see? You see, according to Abaye, the wheat was not one gold dinar, but it was 30 silver dinars. So therefore, Rava come back and explain the Mishnah according to Rava, that here the Mishnah speaks about the value of the produce, and it's the idea is that he speaks about not the debt but the cash. So Elam Rava ki shachivna Rabbi Yoshaya nafak levati. Rava said, when I will die, Rav Hoshaya will come out from heaven to greet my soul. So it's a well-known story, the generation of the Gaon of Vilna, Rabbi Eliyahu of Vilnius. They said that it was a fellow, a great man, that dedicated his life to learn and interpret every statement, because the Gra was very succinct and very short. So this rabbi was dedicated his life to explain, and one day, for such an arduous effort, he turns blind. So the story goes that he asked people to go and take him to the graveside, the Tziyun of the Vilna Gaon. And he went there and he prayed very hard. He says, I'm here only to explain to the people what you meant in your writings, and the miracles happened, and he was healed, and he was able to see again. 63, dim taratzna matnitin kvatei. So Rava, let's say, get used to do it, interpreted the Mishnah, especially those Mishnayot where she said that the Rebbe HaKadosh, Rebbe HaNasi, left, that wasn't 100% clear. Rabbi Yoshaya was one of his students of Rebbe, so he wrote a book, the same as Tosefta. And the Rambam explained in the introduction of the Mishnah that that was one of the goal, the same as Rabbi Chiya did, the Gemara said in the Chulin Kuf Mem Aleph. So he said, the Tane Rabbi Yoshaya, Harei Shaya Noshe Bachaveiro Mane. You have a case that someone has was claiming a debt of, let's say, use Mane, it can be $1,000, for example. Ve'alach ve'amad al gorno. Same way, he stand in the front of the bower threshold. And he said to him, tell me ma'otai shani rotze likach ba'en chitin. Give me the money, I want to buy in that money wheat. ואמר לו, חיטין יש לי שאני נותן לך, צבע, שיער, עליי כשאר של עכשיו, the same scenario. הגיע הזמן חיטין למכור, אמר לו, תן לי חיטין שאני רוצה למוכרם ולקח בהם יין. Give me the wheat, I want to buy in that value a wine. ואמר לו, יש לי יין שאני נותן לך, צבע, שיער, עליי כשאר של עכשיו. הגיע הזמן למכור. So the time came to sell the wine. אבל אמר לו, תן לי עיני שאני רוצה למוכרו ולקח בו שמן. Give me the wine, I want to buy for that wine and oil. אמר לו, שמן שיש לי, שנותן לך צבע שאו עליי כשאר של עכשיו. כולם, all these previous instances, which is the wheat, the wine, the oil. So, מותר. So, you basically have more. income and law if it doesn't have at the present time the wheat, the wine or the oil, so then it's prohibited. So what you see, the Rav Hoshaya, this braita permits if you have a contract that deal with a forward and the contract pay for the wine with the debt, but only when you have this situation that the one who is the seller has a good in his possession at the time of this agreement. That's the idea of Yeshlo. So Rava argued and he said why our Mishnah prohibits the transaction when the debtor has no wine. It was a question that presented to the great Rav of Makawa. A fellow bought a box of wine, let's say for 200 bucks, but it wasn't the season. So he bought it in a very cheap price. Half a year later, he opened one of the bottles and the wine was sour. The wine wasn't good. So he took it back to the fellow, and the fellow accepted back the box, and he gave him back 300. Is that permitted or not? Why? Why give him 300? Because Reuven said to him, when I purchased this box from you, I gave you 200 bucks, the value of that, let's say 12 bottles of wine, at that time I was in the season. Now if I wanted to buy this type of wine at this present moment, half a year later, I need to have in my pocket 300 bucks. So the question is that the problem of rebate or not? For both parties, right? The seller wants to keep a good reputation, so he wanted to please the customer. The customer feels that the 200 he gave him is the value of this present, now it's 300. And maybe each of them is right. But the question is that considering a rebate, the interest? My teacher, Reb Shlomo Zalman Orbach, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, asked a question. He had Reuven and Shimon. Reuven lent Shimon $10,000. And the agreement is that Shimon needs to pay him $10,000 in a year. A year passed by, and Reuven said to him, you know, remember our agreement? You gave me, at that time, $11,000. Why? Because we agreed that if you don't pay me in a year $10,000, so I'm going to charge you a fine of $1,000. Is that okay or not? What's the idea? He said that if you want to reuse the money I'm lending you now, you have to pay a special fine each month. So the question is that considering a fine or considering an interest? It's not as simple as sounds. But Reb Shlomo Zalman Orbach have a response over that, because it may happen that Reuven doesn't have a good credit, and how you call it in our language, hard money lender. So he figured out that 10K I need it now, and it's worth it for me, since I'm doing business with that money, to pay you another 1,000 and keep the money. Right? So it's all question, it's a fine, or it's a real interest. Three things we learn from derivative from this brayta of Rav Hoshaya. Number one, Shmamina de Ma'amidin Milve al Gabei Peirot, that we derive from that the one may convert a loan of money into a debt of specified amount of produce. Velo amrinan, we do not say that is forbidden, de lo keisaro haba leyado, that it's not like a case where the isar coin comes into his hand. So Tosfot explains that that's basically psika bechov, that's basically allowed. The second we learn, ushma mina hu de yeshlo. So you see that the conversion is only permitted when the one who owes the money has the produce in stock, as we explained earlier. That's crucial. And number three, ushmamina itali drabi anai, damar rabi anai mali hen malid mehen. Rabi anai said, what's the real difference between delivering the goods themselves or giving the value of that good as a substitute for them? The itma, that's an Amoraic disputation. Rav amar osim amana befeirot, ve'en osim amana bedamim. Rav said that you can have a special agreement of trust, which is you set up an advance payment for future delivery of certain produce, but you don't do it. Repayment of the produce future cash value. Rabbi Yanai amar malihenu malid mehem. Rabbi Yanai said, come on, what's the difference between delivering the good themselves or giving the values? Meiti veikulam im yesh lo mutar. He said that all this wheat, wine, and oil, if he ever is in his possession, the debtor is permitted to convert his debt into forward contract for other goods. So what you see, the brayta permits substituting wine for wheat and oil for wine, and that's basically opposite of what Rav said. Amar avun amar Rav b'shem ashach, where the creditor perform meshicha of the good, which is Ritva said that that you see it also in the Tosfot, that is a total maaseh kinyan, and therefore can do it. So the Gemara said, "Ib shemashach tzricha lemeima." So Rav Hoshaya Braita need to speak about the situation that the creditor perform meshicha, which is one of the maaseh kinyan, and thereby he acquired their wheat. And it's really important when you speak about the brayta to say that that's the rule and why the brayta need to change. Ela kegon sheyiched lo keren zavit, he designated a special corner in for the creditor to use in store for good. So that's different than when the other produce he doesn't designate a special space. And based on this Gemara, the late Rav Vozhner in Shevet HaLevi tried to say the case of the four partners. You guys remember that? In the introduction, we talk about the question that very prominent Morei Hora'ah. It's a matter of fact that we are very close, that Morei Hora'ah. He said to me once something that touched my heart. He said to me, you know, I'm a Dayan in a Bet Din in Borough Park, New York. And he said, one day he said, you know, today I was asked maybe 100 questions in your Edea. question of a mixture of dairy and meat, question of a certain fish, etc. But he says, it has been a long time that people not ask me a question, choshen mishpat, question when it's related to a monetary disputation between people. People make their own rules. But anyway, so the question he presented to the late Rav Vozhner was, you have, for those who come late, is the four partners that bought a very large property in New Jersey. And since when you're buying a property, especially large, you have issues of fixing things, you have issues of reproduce a new insurance, because as you see, the insurance issues can come up in different avenues, and you always need to check what's the current situation, what's the expecting situation, and more. So the expenses, especially the first 2 years, those who are involved in real estate know, are enormous. And you never expected in the GOI and NOI, the gross operation income and net operation income, the way that the seller presents to you, that's never the real case. So these four partners decided to open a separate trust account and allow each partner to put X amount of money on a monthly basis for the first 2 years. So for example, each partner needs to put $5,000 each month for that account. Obviously, one of the four partners didn't put the money. So they agree that if you don't put the money, you have a fine. They fine you as the four partner in the company, right? So this fellow came after a year and he says, wait guys, I owe the trust account $60,000. You didn't use out all this money for fixing, right? So I actually owe you what I need to pay each month, which is $5,000. Take the $60,000 and goodbye. The other partner said, no, it's nothing to do with interest. It's to do with fine. We agree that that's the original agreement, that if you don't pay the $5,000 a month to that account, we are going to impose upon you a fine. So the question is, how you treat it? You treat it as an interest or you treat it as a fine? It's based on our sugya, as you see, yichad lo keren zavit, when the debtor designated the corner in his premises for him, which is for the creditor used to store the goods. So that's a setup and agreement in advance. So you may argue, and he said, also here, it was a knas, it was a fine, it wasn't a ribit. Ushmuel amar, that's the ma'alach that Rav Vozhner tried to say. Anyway, Ushmuel amar hamani Rabbi Yudai, the amar tzad echad beribit mutar. He said that when you have the contingency, the interest in contingency is one side of a transaction is permitted. So what you see, that you have the this Rav premise, that the substitute for the contracts that have goods contain an element of an interest, but the Braita permits the substitution because the interest is contingent on the decision to make the substitution and is not inherent to the term of the original transaction. In a way, interest, ribit, of this sort is permitted based according to the view of Rabbi Yehuda, and the Braita follows his view. The Tanya, Arei she'a noshe b'chaverom mane, v'asa lo sadeh u'mecher. When you have someone who claim the debt of mane, we're just using mane, but as we said, it's just the coin at that time, and in a payment, the one who owed money made the sale of his field, to transfer the field to the creditor. That is a special stipulation that he did not repay the loan. By the certain day, the creditor will acquire the field retroactively for now. That's usually the collateral that lending institutions does, right? The first question the lending institution asks you when you ask for money is, what is your collateral? We always said the banking business is not to harm you and is not to do auction of a foreclosure of real estate. The banking and lending institution is for one purpose, to make money over their interest. Now, they want to confirm in advance that the collateral either is a free or clear, or you have a guarantor, so they have the interest every month the way that they agreed. That's their business. So here they said, Bizman shamocher ochel perot, mutar. לוקח אוכל פירות, אסור. So if the one who owes take the produce of the field in term, the transaction is permitted. But if, however, the buyer, which is the creditor, takes the produce in the interim, the transaction is forbidden. So he said, Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Rabbi Yehuda said, Af bizman shalokeh ochel perot mutar, even when the buyer, which is the creditor, takes the produce, the transaction is permitted. Why? Because that's what we said, tzad echad beribit elau. Because the eventually what happened is, he's going to pay him what he owes him. אמר להם רבי יהודה, רבי יהודה said to the sages, מעשה בויתוס בן זונין, so that's a story about this fellow, שעשה שדהו מחר, that he satisfied his creditor the way that we just explained, he made a sale of his field to him in a manner that we just described, על פי רבי אלעזר בן עזריה, ולוקח אוכל פירות היה, that the one who takes it can use the produce. Amru lo, the sages said to Rabbi Yehuda, Misham ra'aya, you bring a proof from this case. Mocher chol perot haya velo lokeach. The seller was the one who basically consumed the produce, and not the lokeach, not the buyer. So therefore, that's the reason Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah allowed it. But if the buyer eats the produce, that was forbidden. So, as we said earlier, that's the question based on that, was the response of the Rav of Strasbourg. So, because as we remember, we said in the dealership, you have a fellow that have a lot of cars for those who came late. And he have in that place in Chicago, a lot of cars in his dealership, and he needs immediate fund of 250K, real case. So they came to the Rav of Strasbourg and asked him a question. Because the lender came after a year and said, hey, you owe me 250, I need my money now. So he said to him, look, give me 60 days. I'm giving you cars, I'm giving in my yard, I have several BMWs. You take those cars, the value of 300K. If I don't give you the money in 2 months, you have those cars. So the question is, is that considering in a retail value as a seller and buying? Or, because that's the condition, the real value of this very moment that you acquire your money is not 250, it's 300. So apparently it's not a rebate. But since you have a tnai merosh, a precondition agreement, so he basically saying to him, look, if 60 days I don't pay you, so guess what? You basically can sell it, and when you sell it, you're going to make 50K. So again, that's a rebate. How about if the guy said to him, okay, you didn't pay me in 60 days, I'm putting it for sale, and I'm withholding the buyers, and if in 60 days you don't pay me, I'll sell it, but I'll give you back the 50K. Again, is that okay in a manner of retail buying and selling or not, based on this sugiya? My brother-in-law, in his beautiful book, Daf al Daf, he brought here a question. He said, the Rashi tells us by Tos Ben Zunin, and he brought the Migdanot Natan, that the truth is, when we bring a case of Baitos, he was preceding Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah. So why you say that he followed Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah if he preceding him? So he brought the Erkin, in the Erkin 31, they said, Ma'aseh Baitos ben Zunin she'aseh sadeh u'mecher al pi Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah. So it means that it wasn't preceding, he was at his time. But in short, he's also elaborating the case itself. But the key idea is that, at least apparently, is a manner of buying and selling. So here, Rava derived a new halacha, Amar Rava hashta de Amar Rabbi Yanai, 63b, Malihen, Umalid Mehen Amrinan. So we said, what's the difference between delivering the goods themselves or giving the buyer the cash value of the goods? Let's face many times in the business world, the desperate need for cash exceeded the produce itself. It's worth it for some people to give away, even in a very low price, a produce in exchange of immediate cash. So the Rashi said that the whole idea of Yatzah Ashar, there's a long Rashi here, is the idea how the market value match this, because sometimes the market value is flexible. So if it's a fixed price, so it's different. For example, it's called a kalbai ve'arbai, which is they have a fixed value of certain treasure, certain things. But if it's in a constant change, that's the problem. Mali d'mehen u'malihen name amrin al poskim al shar shebashuk v'aval bishen lo. So we go, we learn from Rabbi Anais the way he rules, that why may enter into a forward contract and make an advance payment on the basis of an existing market price. Obviously, that Rashi, the Rashbah and Ramban have a lot to explain what exactly the fixed price market, but running out of time. So he said, Eiti ve'rav papa ve'ravuna b'drav Yeshua le'rava. Kulam im yesh lo mutar. As we said, yesh lo is a crucial. If you have in your stock the wheat, wine, or oil, so if you have it at the time, in your possession at the time of the agreement, so we allow to make these transactions, and not, like you said earlier, that Yatza Ashar permitted, allow. So he said, Men lo asu, so amar lo hatam alva'a, or the case of Rav Hoshaya in the Braita, you're speaking about transfer of a loan. So it's no cash changes hand. Hachaz vinei, but here, speaking about sale, the seller receives cash from the buyer at the time of the agreement. Rabbi and Rabbi Yosef bring another explanation for this. They said, Rabbi and Rabbi Yosef, Damrei Travayu, Maitama Amru Rabbanan Poskim al Shar Shabashuv, Rafat Bisha Enlo, Damar Leshkila, Tivutach Veshadia Achizrei. So he said to him, the gratitude for your favor is taken away and cast into a thorn hash, which means that this favor you did, it doesn't gain any good. My ahanitle, how good is it for me when the produce turn higher, more? Ihavule zuze biyadi, if I have in my hand in advance the money, Hava mezabnina behenei ubeshilei bezola. So I can potentially purchase that produce for those name of towns in Babylon in cheap price. So if I have originally potential to buy cheap produce in that money, but since the market value already out there, and those produce, basically by having it in my domain, will increase their value. And I did not gain anything by making this pre-existing agreement with you and waiting until now. So the Rosh, Rabbeinu Asher, derived from this statement, he brought a statement we studied in Perek HaMafkid. And he said, when you have this type of situations, you have to incorporate in this settlement all these extraordinary expenses that was hidden with the general transactions. Because you have to remember, in this type of agreement, there is like you go to a, how typical is when you go to a closing in deals, and there's a lot of hidden fees. And there's a lot of things that you'd not expected. So he said, you have to remember when he speaks about this type of negotiation, how about all these small fees? Amar le Abaye le Rav Yosef el ha-me'ata. Mutar lilvot se'a bi'se'a. The Rosh basically said that if it wasn't clear, the lending institution needs to take all those fees. Anyway, el ha-me'ata mutar lilvot se'a bi'se'a mishum demat se'a amar le shkila tivutach v'shadya achizrei. The Amar Lechid, they deduct the Kadchei Be'a Chalbai. which means I didn't lend it to you. So that wheat, over the time with the rain and everything, will ruin. So what do I gain in this type of loan? So why we learn in the Mishnah in 75, page 75, that you cannot lend se'ah be'se'ah. So Amar Lei Hatam Halva'a Hacha Zvinei. You cannot compare the two, because there, in the case of Se'ah for Se'ah, is really typical alone. But here, in the case of forward contract, is a sale. So here is a question based on that. Painful, real, practical question you see in practical halachot. A fellow has a simcha 8 months from now. He's married his daughter. He wanted to make it in a beautiful place in New York City. He goes to that owner of that wedding hall, and they agree on certain price, and they schedule a date 8 months from now. Now the food, there is a certain menu, and there's a price for the food. The owner of that wedding hall, he needs cash. So he said to his fellow, look, you want a plate, for example, for $100 a person, okay? So pay me in advance for, let's say, 300 guests that coming, right? For $100 a person. And I sign a contract that that's a final price. Now, here is the issue of indirect interest, because the reality is price is constant change. And that food that served 8 months from now can be a total different price than they agreed. And meanwhile, the guy who have it, he can use that money for whatever he needs. And the other guys, basically in the normal transactions between parties, can be, God forbid, the daughter decided not to get married, or decided to go marry in different locations, right? A month or two before the wedding. So how you treated this type of situation, especially if it's a food price, as you see here, se'ah be'se'ah, you're paying for the fish and the chicken and whatever you serve in the menu, according to a price, because he needs cash, and the other party based on a menu that everyone agrees 8 months in advance. It's a problem. The same applies when people sell a vacation packages, and they sell you in a special price if it's a half a year in advance. So again, this is the same issues. If you pay in advance, I'm not talking about using credit card and paying later, but you're paying in advance for a certain cash price for a very cheap package. Is that the issue of interest or not? Anyway, especially if you cancel it, right? And then they guarantee to give you the money back, right? So the question is, how you treated the problem with rebate based on that? Because what we said here, we have to differentiate between a loan than a contract of sale. Amar l'rabada baraba l'rabba, v'abay l'meitav zuzei l'saf seira. So he basically gave money to a broker to introduce him to sellers. So here we have the broker's fee he saves by placing forward the contract. Amar lei, Rabba respond to Rabba Rabba Rabba, dekayahiv lei namei, that the buyer must also give the seller the brokerage fee, which sometimes that's part of the deal, right? Rabba Shiamar, zuzedin sheinhu avdelei safserutei. So he said, a man's fund do the service of brokerage for him, which means that when a person have cash, it's a total different status. The people who sell the produce come by themselves to sell the produce to him. He doesn't need a broker to go in between them. So it means the one who get it, the purchaser, doesn't make any money for setting up a price for those produce. So, by the way, they go and said further on, Rabba v'Rav Yosef d'Amri itravayu, high mind ayayiv zuzei atar'ah harifa. The fellow that gives money for produce in an early price. צריך להתחזויי לבי דרי. He must appear at the seller's threshing floor to inspect the produce and thereby confirm the sale. Lemai, what's the purpose of doing though? Ile mikna, if it's to acquire the produce outright. Halokane, cannot be, because the appearance cannot acquire the produce for him. Ile kabulei alei mi shepara, if to accept upon himself the rules of Mishepara, that we learn many times, that if someone make an agreement on good faith and then he backed out, so we learn that it's a formal rules that administered by the rabbinic court to a party that retract from an agreement before the transaction has been consummated with the appropriate Maase Kinyan. So therefore, those who enter into the agreement, the parties, without any formality, do not come within the scope of Mishepara. So they said, "Ki lo mitchazei namei mekabel ale Mishepara." So if, even if the buyer does not appear at the threshing floor, the seller nevertheless has to take upon himself the Mishepara if he retracts. Why? Because you already pay him cash. Leolam lekabulei ale Mishepara. If he backed out from that deal, the seller, he obligated to. Uman de'ayiv zuzei atar'a, or some say atar'a harifa. And he says that the one who accept upon himself the because he had to give money at the early price, levei treit lata yahiv. So usually gives the two or three sellers. And he said, in order to see which one have the best produce, im itchazelei, if the buyer appears before him to inspect the produce, samcha da'atei, so the seller relies on the sale, and therefore subject to Mishepara if he retract. Ve'ilo, but if the buyer does not appear, amar lei, the seller can say to the buyer, amin adashkechat peri deshapire mididi veshakart, I thought that you found produce better than mine, and you took it. Amar avashe, ashtad amar mishum ismach adada, afilu ashkecha beshuka ve'amar lei samcha data. If and if I'm in the street, the seller relies on the assurance and is not subject to Mishepara if he changes his mind. Amar Rav Nachman, klala de ribita, the general rule when it's come to a law of interest, kol agar natar lei asu, any type of reward for waiting to cash money is forbidden, even in a way of buying and selling. So if he reduced the price, the seller reduced the price because he paid him in advance, so it's the issue of rebid. V'amarav Nachman, haimayin de'ayiv, soon we're going to discuss the example we just used. Haimayin de'ayiv zuze likira. So he give example, the one who give money to wax merchant, that in that in those days to buy cakes of wax. Ve'ka'azil arba arba, that's the merchant said that the buyer, that's the four parzus. V'amar le'ayiv nala chamesh chamesh, itnu gabei share. לתנו גבי אסור, זה כמו שפשיטה, לא צריך להתלי אשראי במטה. מה עוד אתם הכיוון להתלי אשראי במטה? כי עד שיבוא בני או עד שאמצע מפתח דמי, כמה שמינן, כיוון מחסר גוביינו, כמה נתלידנו נמי. So, in short, what we'd like to conclude here, we use the car dealership as an example. So, the car dealership, the issue here is what exactly they entered to agreement, and what exactly was advance agreement. Because the retail price is not the key issue. The key issue is what's the value price of the cars. Because if you give him X amount of, for example, BMW, that's worth, for example, X amount, let's say 250, that's the amount he owe him at this very, very moment, is one thing. But to buy and sell it and make the profit It's all depend upon what exactly the agreements between the parties. Because it appears that we have here two separate agreements between two parties. It was the original agreements, and then the, by force of circumstance, a new agreement, which is different. And then we enter the question of ribit. And as we said many times, that when it's come to those questions, is a person should have a she'elat chacham, go to a prominent posek, and not rule just based on our shiur.